But well, let's move into education.
Mm-hmm. Education is, I think, one of those sort of sleeper areas that's less obvious. I had a great college experience, high school experience. I know a lot of other people did. And I think the changes that you're seeing there are subtle but very real. And the college campuses, Sean, it's driven in part by the fact that a lot of Chinese money is flowing into our universities. You've got people that are connected with the Chinese regime who got very rich. They formed these massive companies like Alibaba with the help of the Chinese government. Alibaba is kind of like the Amazon of China. And what they do is they take that money and they donate it to colleges and universities in the United States. So the first impression would be, oh, that's great. Well, they're interested in just, you know, helping American education. But when you start to see who these people are, what their line is, the strings that they're attaching to this money, and the strings aren't always visible. It's not like twine, it's more like fishing line. You know, there's an attachment there, but you can't really see it. And then you start to see the effects that it's having in college campuses, in chilling the debate about China, in sort of putting out pro-Chinese regime propaganda. That's when you start to get really concerned and you see again the kind of brilliance, troubling brilliance of the Chinese approach.
Do you see any propaganda yet in the universities? Or
absolutely. I mean, so one of the things I focus on in Red Handed in the university chapter is Yale University. There's a guy named Joe Tsai who co-founded Alibaba, fabulously successful. He's probably worth $15 to $20 billion. He goes around on college campuses in California and elsewhere and talks about how great the Chinese regime is. No, you don't understand. The human rights situation is just not a problem. No. What's going on in Hong Kong is not really going on in Hong Kong. He's basically shilling for the regime. He's also, by the way, an owner of the Brooklyn Nets NBA team. So when you see a lot of the stuff involving censorship of the NBA about China, that's part of where it's coming from. But Tsai has given hundreds of millions of dollars to American universities, including Yale. And at Yale, he set up something called the Paul Tsai Center, named after his father, for Chinese legal studies. And I went and looked at what the Paul Tsai Center for Chinese Legal Studies is saying. And what they've been saying, as President Xi of China has become more oppressive, more authoritarian, throwing more people into jail than, you know, all of his recent predecessors, they're saying, oh no, things in China are great. It's becoming a more law-oriented society. President Xi is really improving the way that the government works in China. I mean, it's ridiculous sort of stuff. The other thing that's happening is students at Yale, and I quote them in the book, talk about how Tsai's money and the university's hunger for Tsai's money has led to a chilling of the debate on college campus, on the Yale campus, where students don't feel like they can criticize human rights in China. There's some Tibetan students that are there that said you can't really criticize the Chinese government because the university doesn't like it because it's going to affect the flow of this money from China. And that's just at Yale. That's just going on college campuses all across the country. And colleges and universities, Sean, are required to disclose by law, by federal law, foreign money, but they hide it. So Joe Tsai, who makes his money from Alibaba in China, that's where his business is, that's where his wealth comes from, donates it from an offshore island near the UK called Guernsey. So if you look at Yale, where their foreign donations come from, they will say their biggest foreign donor is the island of Guernsey.
Oh, man.
And it's not. It's coming from China. But they successfully skew it. I would argue what they're doing is illegal.
Yeah.
Because the law is pretty clear. You need to show where the origin of it is. But they're trying to hide it and mask it, and Yale is not alone in doing this.
How long has this been going on at the universities?
I would say probably 15 or 20 years. But over the last 4 or 5 years, it's really ramped up because, you know, in the early 2000s, obviously there were wealthy people in China linked to the regime, but there are a lot more of them now. I mean, the Chinese economy today is, you know, probably 4 or 5 times the size it was 20 years ago. because it's had this massive growth. So you have dozens, if not hundreds of people like Joe Tsai who can donate to universities. They're linked to the regime, they're pro-regime, and they're cutting checks to Stanford, Harvard, Yale, state universities. And, you know, even University of Montana, which people would think, oh, you know, why would China be interested there? There are Chinese connections at the University of Montana as well. It's everywhere.
Wow. Do you think this is reversible?
I think I am optimistic enough that the American people don't like this. They don't like the fact that it's being hidden, that it's changing the debate on campus. The problem is I don't think they're aware of it. They're not aware of it. And I always view the public in the United States as this really quiet, docile, large beast that when awakened, watch out. And I think it needs to be awakened. And I think when it's awakened, you need to start asking hard questions at these universities about the strings attached, forcing them to reveal what they're doing. And I think some alumni should insist that that this money is tainted, that they don't want this money on their campus. But the first thing is people have to become aware that this is actually going on and that there's a, I would argue, nefarious purpose behind it.
Do you think that they're going to start concentrating on lower education, like high schools, elementary schools, middle schools, or are they going to stick with the universities?
Well, yeah, I think they will. They'll look for opportunities. There are these things called Confucian Institutes that operate around the United States. A lot of them are in college towns, and they're ostensibly there to teach young people, including high school students, how to speak Chinese, which I think is great. I think learning foreign languages is wonderful. The problem is a lot of people that have looked at these Confucian Institutes see them as propaganda arms, because a lot of the material and literature that they put out for people to learn to read or to learn about China is obviously very pro-regime. So absolutely, I think they are going to look for these opportunities anywhere that they can. And it's only going to get worse. And my point, one of the things I talk about at the end of the book, Sean, is all of this stuff would be fine if they were allowing us to do it in China. Because I really believe, and I know you believe the same way, you know, in a competition for like the attractiveness of a way of life, of a civilization, I think we win that against anybody. But the problem is we can't do that in China. Yeah. So I think with anything with China, we should insist on reciprocity, meaning you can do it here if we can do it there. Yeah. And if you're not going to let us do it in your country, we're not going to let you do it in our country.
Yeah, I would definitely agree with that.